Welcome to the second section in our series of diet and health. This section is covering cardiovascular disease and specifically heart disease. Cardiovascular disease refers to any type of disease of the heart or the cardiovascular system, whereas heart disease, we're usually referring to atherosclerosis. Now, atherosclerosis is a disease that's characterized by plaque. But if there's one thing I want you to get out of this section, is that heart disease is not just a clogging of the arteries with fat. In fact, you'll definitely be asked a question on the test about that, and that is definitely the wrong answer. It is characterized by plaque, but is actually a complex inflammatory process. We'll start with atherosclerosis. There's usually the initiating factor is a damage to the artery wall. And there are a number of factors that can cause damage to the artery wall, but some of the main factors are smoking, aging, and oxidative stress. These damage that inside lining, the endothelial lining of the artery wall. So what happens when you cut yourself? If you cut yourself on your skin, what happens? Well, you have a little bit of redness, a little bit of swelling, there might even be a little bit of pain or itching. And your body is trying to heal itself. Well, that's the same process that happens in the arteries, but slightly different. So the second part is the fatty streak. And this is your body responding to the damage in the artery wall, one with inflammation. With this inflammation, it is cleaning up. There are certain cells or macrophages go in, they try to clean up any of that excess debris. In the process, they're going to scoop up some of the LDL. Remember, LDLs are low-density lipoprotein. It's delivering cholesterol to the body's organs, tissues, cells, wherever we need them. In this case, the cholesterol will help with repair. Remember, most of our cell linings, cell walls are made with cholesterol. But LDL can get oxidized, and that's actually not a good part of the process. And that's why antioxidants generally help slow the progression of atherosclerosis, as well as other foods which help inhibit inflammation. Now, although inflammation is part of the repair process, we don't want it to go on too long, because then we end up getting to the plaque stage that most people are familiar with. And this is where the smooth muscle from the vessel walls will invade into the plaque, and the plaque will actually, if you think of the vessel wall expanding like this, it'll actually start expanding out, and it gets a fibrous cap on top of that. This is where calcium deposits can come in. There's calcification. Now, you can have a plaque, and in fact, most of you have plaque in your arteries right now, and you're not going to experience any symptoms from that. It also doesn't mean you're going to die of a heart attack either. Most people will have fatty streaks even in their teenage years. So as we go and progress on to the plaque stage, most problems with atherosclerosis that will lead to symptoms, say angina, which means chest pain, especially on exertion when you're doing physical activity, some people will have that plaque expand enough to where it is blocking the flow. So it will lead to some chest pain, but they don't necessarily go on to a heart attack, because what a heart attack is a rupture of that plaque. It becomes unstable. It ruptures. It travels essentially downstream, down through the arteries to the smaller artery, and then it blocks the flow of blood. That means that oxygen can't get to the heart tissue. If the heart, you know, that's beating doesn't get any oxygen, it's going to die and it can't actually do its job. So that's why it's so dangerous. But the rupture is what leads to the heart attack, and a heart attack is the layman term for what's called a myomuscle, cardial's heart, and then infarction, so a blockage of blood flow to the heart muscle or heart tissue. Now, through this, 85% about of myocardial infarctions or heart attacks are caused from the rupture, from these unstable plaques, not from the plaque expanding in and blocking the blood flow. So again, my stress to you is look how complex this process is. Look at all of the stages, that there's oxidative stress and damage and inflammation and oxidation, and it's not fat clogging your arteries. That is just that's what I definitely want you to get out of this this presentation, and a general understanding of how what a complex inflammatory process this disease is. It was interesting, is some research that came out fairly recently in June of 2014, is they found when they did whole body CT scans of ancient mummies, they found they had calcified arteries. And this is fascinating. It kind of shocked everybody. And remember, this is just the calcification of the arteries, calcium deposit within the artery linings. They can't actually determine if it's atherosclerosis because you're not going to see the smooth muscle lining, you're not going to see the LDL or the macrophages or anything else in there. You're just going to see the calcium. So it's a representation of what, when they died, how much atherosclerosis they may have had. What was interesting is it's similar to modern Egyptians, and then when they studied other mummies from around the world, very similar. Well, this shocked everybody because we thought it was our sedentary lives, we're on the computer, we're playing video games, we're in cars, we're eating junk food and fast food, and we thought that contributed to heart disease. And it still probably does, because when they look back, they're trying to figure out, well, how do we live this modern life and have calcified arteries, yet they did, you know, ancient Egyptian mummies did as well. Well, in those days, they were exposed to a lot of campfire smoke, which is a lot of oxidation that is going, that's oxidative stress damaging the lining. So they had more of that than we have today. Poor hygiene and persistent infections, those are also going to not only damage artery lining, theoretically, but also are going to contribute to prolonged inflammation. So they had different factors that might be contributing. So that's their theory for why the ancient Egyptians had calcified arteries that are similar to the modern Egyptians. It's really fascinating when this research came out. So let's talk about risk factors for heart disease. CAD is coronary artery disease. Well, think about those as, remember, factors that are associated with increasing the risk of developing the disease. So non-modifiable, what does that mean? That means these are things we can't change. You're stuck with it. So we all get older, and as we age, we have an increased risk. We have more oxidative stress as we age. It's just something that we're not going to be able to control. The male gender, can't change your gender, so men are going to be at greater risk than women. And then there's a family history. Family history, if you have an immediate family member with heart disease, it's actually a very powerful risk factor. And so this is our genetic component. Now I have George Burns on here because it's kind of the opposite of this example. He, you know, smoked cigars, didn't eat well, wasn't really active, lived to be over 100. So we had genetics that protected him from heart disease. You, some other individuals might have the opposite. So these are things we can't change. But what about things we can change? Well, one is going to be an increasing weight. We know that obesity is definitely a risk, a modifiable risk factor. Tobacco is probably one of the most powerful risk factors for heart disease. And when I say modifiable, I mean, you know, you have the choice to smoke or not. You can control weight to a certain extent. So these are things that can be changed or modified that you or individuals have control over. Now, one of the next ones is our blood pressure. So high blood pressure, called hypertension, we're going to discuss that next, is also a risk factor for developing heart disease. Blood lipids. So when we think of abnormal blood lipids, we call this either hyperlipidemia or dyslipidemia. And that means if you have a high LDL or a low HDL, that's going to increase your risk for heart disease. LDL does not cause heart disease. Remember, these are associations, they're risk factors, they're variables. Small, dense LDL, as I went over in the notes, is going to be a greater, and we talked about in chapter 5, it's going to be a greater risk factor than having a large, more large buoyant LDL. So And then there are also genetic factors that you can have a low HDL and not die of heart disease. So remember, LDL doesn't cause heart disease. HDL isn't going to save you from heart disease. But they are basically are lipoproteins. They are associations. So when we see those, we have to think about ways to modify them. And I want to point out in one of a recent study that looked at, and a lot of drugs have been aimed at lowering, elevating HDL and lowering LDL. And what they found is that niacin in particular will help to elevate HDL. And people who have higher HDLs will have a lower risk of developing heart disease. But what they found is, in some of these studies, especially when they added it to a statin, and we're not going to go into these drugs, is that you can elevate the HDL, but that group of individuals does not have better outcomes, meaning that even if LDL goes up, and niacin has been shown to elevate HDL, it doesn't decrease the risk of having a heart attack. So that's one thing. We have to think about association and causation. And it's great that they've come to these conclusions now, going, well, we need to pull back and go, maybe let's not give a bunch of drugs to try and lower LDL and elevate HDL when these aren't really our causative factors. They are, you know, associations, they're variables, they're representations of what are going on in our body. So that's just an aside of some recent research and going over correlation and causation. Insulin resistance, and in particular diabetes, is going to be an increased risk factor for the development of heart disease. This is something I see all the time in my practice. Most diabetics do end up developing heart disease. And of course, sedentary behavior, so a lack of exercise, is going to increase the risk of developing heart disease. So what can you do about it? Well, all of those factors I just discussed were modifiable. And a lot of it has to do with how active we are, the environment that we live in, and, you know, what we eat. So, and I know I just talked about the research with the mummies, of course, but they had different exposures, environmental exposures, than we do. Now, our environmental exposures are, you can barely see this in the back, this big old hamburger in here. It's mostly our diet. So we looked at high and processed, and I should have an and here, high and processed and saturated fat. So certain types of saturated fat. Remember I talked about, we're just now, the new research is coming out about how some types of saturated fat might be more problematic than others. But processed fats, absolutely. Trans fats in particular. High in cholesterol. Cholesterol does not cause heart disease. Very important to understand. But diets that are really high in cholesterol are associated with an increased risk of heart disease. High in refined grains. Remember I talked about this in chapter 5. Refined grains, refined carbohydrates, a lot of processed breads and really refined pastas. You have your crackers and your cookies and your cakes and all the cereals. 98% of those cereals on the cereal aisle. And all those refined grains are going to increase the risk of heart disease. It increases that small, dense LDL. And of course, low in plant food in general. Low in fruits and vegetables. A diet that is really high in whole plant food is going to have a lower risk. It's going to lower your risk of developing heart disease. Now, what do you notice about this, this diet? It's the exact opposite of what I've been talking about the entire semester. So the diet that I've been recommending for you, which is high in whole foods, especially a lot of whole plant foods, is going to be a better diet to decrease your risk of heart disease. All right, well, this will be the end of our section on heart disease, and the next section will cover hypertension.